It's morning at the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan, where an American astronaut and two Russian cosmonauts are already atop the 160-foot-tall Soyuz booster, ready for today's launch, an hour from now at 12:45 a.m. Central Time, 10:45 a.m. in Baikonur. This is a live view of the Soyuz rocket on the Site 31 launch pad at Baikonur. This is the second crewed launch on the upgraded Soyuz 2.1A booster, which made its first uncrewed flight with a Soyuz spacecraft on the to the International Space Station in the summer of 2019. The first flight with people on board on a new Soyuz 2.1A booster launched from Site 31 in April of this year. Today, a team of launch controllers are watching over all the systems aboard the rocket, which is now fully fueled and ready for launch. No issues are being tracked throughout today, which began with fuel and oxidizer loading at about 7:45 p.m. Central Tuesday, which is 3:45 a.m. Wednesday, out at the launch site in Baikonur. Loading was completed about 2 hours later. Hello, everyone, from Mission Control in Houston. I'm Brandy Dean. Here in Mission Control, the team is watching over the Expedition 63 crew and space station systems and preparing to support the arrival of Soyuz MS-17. The station's population will increase from 3 to 6 with the addition of NASA astronaut Kate Rubens, Russian cosmonaut Sergei Kuzmichkov, and Russian cosmonaut and Soyuz commander Sergei Ryzhkov. These three are about to begin the first planned two-orbit flight to the International Space Station with humans on board, and their docking is scheduled approximately 3 hours after launch at 3:52 a.m. Central Time or 1:52 p.m. Wednesday, October 14th in Baikonur, where NASA and Roscosmos support teams and officials will be watching the events unfold. The Soyuz MS-17 spacecraft will be docking with the Rosvet docking port on the Earth-facing side of the Russian segment of the space station. Once there, the crew will join the three current space station residents on board. That's NASA astronaut and space station commander Chris Cassidy and Russian cosmonauts Anatoly Ivanishin and Ivan Wagner. They arrived at the space station aboard Soyuz MS-16 in April. Sergei Ryzhkov will take over as the Expedition 64 commander at the change of command ceremony before the crew goes to bed on October 20th, the day prior to Cassidy, Ivanishin, and Wagner undocking from the station and returning to Earth aboard Soyuz MS-16. Rubens, Ryzhkov, and Kuzmichkov will be left behind to celebrate the 20th anniversary of human presence on board the International Space Station, which is coming up soon now on November 2nd. In the meantime, here in Houston, the team in Mission Control will be monitoring today's launch and getting updates from the flight from their Russian counterparts. Flight Director Marcos Flores will be on console for the Soyuz launch today, and Capcom for today's launch is ESA astronaut Andreas Mogensen. During the Soyuz climb to orbit, tracking and telemetry is downlinked to ground stations along its flight path and routed to the Russian Mission Control Center outside of Moscow, which you're seeing a view of here. And throughout tonight's coverage, we'll be trying to answer your questions about the launch, which you can submit via social media. If you have any questions you'd like to have us answer, you can send those now to us using the hashtag AskNASA. We'll try and answer a few of those soon, so go ahead and send them in.
Copied well.
Today's launch marks the second flight into space for NASA astronaut Kate Rubens, the second for Russian cosmonaut and Soyuz MS-17 commander Sergei Ryzhkov, and the first for Russian cosmonaut Sergei Kuzmichkov of Roscosmos. Let's take a moment to learn more about Dr. Kate Rubens, NASA's next astronaut to fly in space, and her work aboard the International Space Station.
The reason that you would do any kind of experiment in space is if there's something particular about the space environment. And most often, that is microgravity. So mostly the ISS gives us the ability to either do something that we can't do in a facility on Earth or investigate some phenomenon, some property in a way that we can't on Earth. So for example, some of the tissue architecture, these really delicate tissues, as you start to build them up, they would collapse. because you have gravity, or the cells would naturally settle to the bottom of the plate. And so you just can't study the answer to the question that you're looking for. So the space station lets us have that ability to either test what the effect of gravity is or remove that problem entirely from our experimental setup. Yeah, the space station's an incredible place to conduct research. It was sort of like being in the world's most amazing lab when I was up there in 2016. So when you're a scientist, you're used to working on one thing over and over and maybe really refining the details on that over the course of a PhD thesis or a lab project. On space station, you get somebody's incredibly refined project times 200 different fields. So for me, it was a chance to learn about all these different areas of science, and they each have a team behind them. So I was usually pretty excited to open the container and do whatever experiment that day brought. I also really got a chance to talk to those PIs, the principal investigators, and the scientific teams, and understand everything that was going on behind their experiments and read their papers. So by the time I got to doing the experiment, I was pretty excited to take it out and to see what was going to change in microgravity. Yeah, science in space, it's an amazing lab and it's incredibly fun. So we are smiling all the time. I'm Kate Rubens. I'm a scientist and an astronaut.
And raised in Napa, California, NASA astronaut Dr. Kate Rubens conducted her undergraduate research on HIV-1 integration in the Infectious Diseases Laboratory at the Salk Institute for Biological Studies, earning a bachelor's degree in molecular biology from the University of California, San Diego, in 1999. She earned a PhD in cancer biology from Stanford University Medical School's Biochemistry Department and Microbiology and Immunology Department, with the U.S. Army Medical Research Institute of Infectious Diseases and the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, Rubens and her colleagues developed the first model of smallpox infection. She also studied pox virus and virus-host interactions. Rubens then accepted a fellowship position as a principal investigator at the Whitehead Institute for Biomedical Research at MIT in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and headed a lab of 14 researchers studying viral diseases that primarily affect Central and West Africa. She presented her work at numerous international scientific conferences and was published in many scientific journals. Then, in July 2009, after applying on a whim, Rubens was selected as one of 9 members of the 2009 NASA astronaut class. She launched into space for the first time aboard Soyuz MS-1 in 2016 as part of Expeditions 48 and 49. During that mission, Rubens became the first person to sequence DNA in space. In addition, she conducted 2 spacewalks along with astronaut Jeff Williams, installing the first docking port for U.S. Commercial Crew spacecraft. Rubens is seated to the right of the Soyuz commander, Roscosmos cosmonaut Sergei Ryzhikov, who is returning to space for the second time today. Born in Bogulma, Tatarstan, Russia, Ryzhikov went to high school and young aviators school in the Tumen region of Russia. Afterward, he attended Kachka Air Force Pilot School, graduating in 1996 as a pilot engineer. Ryzhikov served as a pilot in the Russian Air Force from 1996 to 2007. By the time of his selection by the Cosmonaut Corps, he was a military pilot of the second class, having logged more than 700 flight hours piloting the L-9 and MiG-29 planes. He is certified as a military officer diver and paratrooper instructor with more than 350 parachute jumps. After beginning his training in 2006 as a member of Class 14 of the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center Cosmonaut Corps, Ryzhikov completed basic spaceflight training in 2009, qualifying as a test cosmonaut. His first trip into space was in 2016 as the Soyuz MS-02 commander and as a flight engineer for Space Station Expeditions 49 and 50. While aboard, he conducted dozens of Russian science program experiments in medicine, space biology, biotechnology, physics, and chemistry, among others. His call sign is FAVOR, a reference to Mount Tabor in Israel. Ryzhikov is serving as the MS-17 commander and will become a space station commander as well when Expedition 64 begins. Seated to his left is first-time flyer Roscosmos cosmonaut Sergei Kuzmichkov. Born in Linetsk, now Baikonur, in the Kislorda region of Kazakhstan, Kuzmichkov went to high school in Korolev in the Moscow region of Russia, graduating in 2000. In 2006, he graduated with a first-class honors degree from the Moscow Bauman Technical University as a rocket engine engineer. He went on to serve at the Energia Rocket and Space Corporation as an engineer from 2006 to 2009. In 2010, he was admitted into Class 17 of the Energia Rocket and Space Corporation Cosmonaut Corps, completing his training and qualifying as a test cosmonaut in 2012. From August 2012 to October 2019, he took advanced training, specializing in the space station program. Working from the left seat today as Soyuz MS-17 Flight Engineer 1, Kuzmichkov will serve aboard the space station as an Expedition 64 flight engineer. Once again, we are taking questions online via the hashtag AskNASA. So if you're following along on social media, you can get your questions into us. And we have a couple that have already been submitted that we'll go ahead and try to answer for you now. This first one coming from Rob Wood in the UK, asking, when will Chris Cassidy return from the space station? Cassidy is on board now with two other Russian cosmonauts, and they are all going to be returning next week. They'll have just a short handover time where they can make sure that they're colleagues that are on their way today will be ready to take care of the space station once they've left, and then they will be coming home on October 21st. Just like tonight, you'll be able to watch all of our coverage of those events, starting with their undocking and then a return to the Kazakhstan, where they'll be touching down. That coverage will begin at 7 p.m. Central Time on Wednesday, October 21st, just a week from now. We also have a second question, this one coming from Omar, and asking whether or not astronauts ever suffer from motion sickness. And it varies from astronaut to astronaut, but there are definitely some who suffer from a little bit of motion sickness when they first go to space, and then also when they return from space, they tend to have they can have trouble adjusting to the return of gravity in their lives. That can be a little rough on both ends. So when they arrive at the space station, they're given a little time to adjust. There's some time built into their schedule specifically for microgravity adjustment. And then once they return, a lot of times you'll see the people who are supporting them on the ground being very careful to help them move around, make sure that they've got some support once they get out of the spacecraft and onto solid ground again, to make sure that they have all the help that's possible adjusting to that first feel of gravity for once after they've returned. You can keep sending those in using the hashtag AskNASA, but one of the questions that we often get is about the cruise patch. And we actually have a clip now of Kate Rubens explaining that during a recent news conference.
The 64 patch is actually a photograph that I took when I was on board ISS the last time. And it's the underside of the International Space Station as we're flying over city lights in Europe. And so you can see all the lights of these cities being reflected on the underside of the space station. I just thought it was this great analogy of the connectedness between Earth and space, and the fact that you've got lights in these cities down below, and they're reflected in the space station, and then you can see, of course, the space station pass overhead one of those cities at night.
Back now with a live view of the Soyuz on the launch pad in Baikonur as we continue our coverage of the launch of Kate Rubens, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kuzmichkov to the International Space Station. We're now 45 minutes away from today's launch, with liftoff scheduled for 12:45 a.m. Central Time, 10:45 a.m. in Baikonur. And just a reminder that we are taking those questions, so keep sending them in using the hashtag AskNASA.
Oh. 16 третий Фавора. Скафандр герметичный.
16-3. This is the Taboris. The time is 4:03:20. 1:21 for the first, 1:41 for the second. The pressure is 816 in the descent module. Oxygen pressure is 209. Copy. In the tanks of the PHO, the second section is 208 and 224 in the second section as well. Tabor, I am 16-3. I understand that the suits are airtight. I've also received the pressure on oxygen inside the vehicle. I understand.
Мы можем включить вам музыку.
По связи, Фаворе, сами готовы. Докладываем, что сигнализация...
As I was saying, you can send in your questions to us using the hashtag AskNASA, and we've got a few more ready for you now. The next one coming from Pratham, who is asking... how long will these astronauts stay on board the space station? The plan right now is for them to stay about 6 months, which is about the standard amount of time. That is always a little dependent on circumstances. But in this case, and for the most part, the astronauts will stay about 6 months at a time, which gives them a good chance to get very used to the International Space Station and really dig in on the work that goes on there and contribute to the science that the space station does and keep it in good working order. And we also have another one, this one coming in from Dan, asking how many astronauts can the space station accommodate and how many are there at this time. Right now, we've just got the three members of the Expedition 63 crew waiting for this new influx of astronauts who are on their way today. Once they get there, of course, there will be six for a short amount of time, and then they will soon be joined by the SpaceX Crew 1 crew. They'll be launching in November and joining them. That'll add four more people to the space station, bringing that total of up to seven, which we are hoping to have be kind of the normal number for the space station crew now that our commercial crew partners are beginning to launch crew to the International Space Station. That's not the limit of what the space station can accommodate, though. That'll be kind of the normal operating amount, but when there are handovers, like we'll be experiencing this week, while Chris Cassidy is welcoming Kate Rubens and her crewmate to the space station, there will be a few more there, so there could be as many as about 9 or 10 there at a time.
Copy it well, thank you.
Here in just a moment, we'll begin seeing some video that's been recorded over the course of the day as the crew walk through their activities leading up to today's launch. But once again, you can keep submitting those questions using the hashtag AskNASA, and we'll try and take a few more before today's broadcast is over. And here is the promise video showing what the crew has been up to today as they prepared for their launch. The day's activities in Baikonur began several hours ago as the crew was awakened around 2 p.m. Central Time on Tuesday, or midnight local time on Wednesday in Baikonur, about 10 hours and 45 minutes ahead of their launch. Crew members here you see participating in that time-honored tradition that they always do in Baikonur, signing the doors of the rooms that they stayed in at their crew quarters, or at the Cosmonaut Hotel in the town of Baikonur. Around 5:45 p.m. Central on Tuesday, 3:45 a.m. Wednesday in Baikonur, the crew then departed the Cosmonaut Hotel and boarded a bus for a 40-minute ride to the Integration and Suit-Up Facility. That's Building 254 inside the Baikonur Cosmodrome. You can see them walking out from the hotel here. The crowd much more limited than usual due to the restrictions associated with coronavirus precautions. Still just a few people who were able to attend, not carefully controlled, but normally the crew's family would be there, as well as a pretty good contingent of VIPs, but that wasn't possible for this launch due to those precautions. Rubens, Ruzhikov, and Kudzklerchkov again getting on the bus here to take that 40-minute ride to the building where they get into their spacesuits, the Integration and Suit-Up Facility. Waving some final goodbyes to the crowd that was able to come out and watch. Crew spends their last few weeks ahead of launch in that hotel. They have a little bit of time to rest and do some last-minute studying, making sure that they are ready for the launch and all the activities that come along with it. And pulling away here from the Baikonur, the Cosmonaut Hotel in Baikonur, again heading to the building where they get into their so-called spacesuits. This ride takes about 40 minutes, and then they arrive at the Integration Building, where each crew member underwent final medical exams and then suited up in their launch and entry suits. The suits are pressurized to ensure that they're free from leaks. As program officials look on through protective glass, it helps them maintain quarantine. Suit up takes about 5.5 hours, or is completed about 5.5 hours ahead of launch. Sergei Ryzhikov there, getting his spacesuit checked out. And Sergei Kudzberchkov there.
Thank you.
And NASA astronaut Kate Rubins here getting into her suit. This again all took place about 5 hours ago. In the integration and suit-up facility at the Baikonur Cosmodrome, that's building 254. So the crew's first stop after leaving the Cosmonaut Hotel. They went through a series of checks here to make sure the suits were leak-free and would be ready to serve them during today's launch. And taking a few minutes there to grab a little bit of rest before the launch, which is now just 34 minutes away. Again, this video was recorded earlier during the day as the crew was making their final preparations. Once again, this is a view of Kate Rubins getting her spacesuit ready to go. It is a long day for the crew with those with their wake-up call coming again about 10 hours and 45 minutes ahead of their launch, and quite a bit of time to go once they do launch to make their way to the International Space Station, although this trip will be shorter than any previous trip that Soyuz crews have made. We'll be making this trip in just two orbits rather than the usual four or even more. Seeing those leak checks that occurred earlier today here. The crew's also in real time going through some final leak checks as well, and that was actually completed just a moment ago. All good readings from those leak checks, so they should be ready to take off on time at 12:45 a.m. Central tonight. Continuing to see video from today's earlier preparations. This again was the crew's first stop after they left the Cosmonaut Hotel this morning. Here seeing Kate Rubins get her suit leak check. And the crew here pausing for a photo op with their backup crew members. And just on the other side of the glass, out of view here, number of VIPs and guests are watching. Again, a smaller group than usual, but still a good number of people interested in their launch, all behind a glass that helps protect the crew members. That glass is always there, but especially important right now with the COVID restrictions that are protecting them before they make their way to the International Space Station. Those have been very, very strictly watched throughout.
Good morning. Happy birthday, Kate. We have a great space station that's waiting the 3 years arrival, and we're looking forward to seeing you on orbit, all three of you. Congratulations.
Woo!
With Space Station Program Manager Joel Montalbano giving his well wishes to the crew.
We will be glad to see you in a few hours, just a little over 3 hours after launch. When you arrive on station, have a safe trip and a great arrival on station. It is an honor to continue this tradition. You started it, Mr. Krikalev, and we are continuing it 20 years later. Thank you. Okay, let's get down to work. Thank you.
Following those leak checks and some final well wishes from the managers and from NASA and Roscosmos there who were watching the proceedings, they again went on to maintain tradition and strode out of the Site 254 integration building towards Russian managers to declare one final time that they're ready for launch. This is taking place about 8:59 p.m. Central Time on Tuesday, 4:59 a.m. Wednesday in Baikonur. And here you can see them boarding their bus again, this time for the ride to Launch Pad 31.
All the best of luck to everyone. Everything will be great. You will be awesome.
Final goodbyes also to their backup crew, now relieved of their duty. That was Mark Vandehei that Kate Rubens was saying goodbye to there. The drive to the pad took about 50 minutes, and they arrived at 10:14 p.m. Central Time or 8:14 a.m. Wednesday in Baikonur.
Okay, please look here.
And of course, this would not be the time to trip and fall, and those so-called spacesuits aren't the easiest thing to walk in, so they're helped carefully there to the to their rocket, where they climb just a few stairs. Turned to wave goodbye to well-wishers before getting into an elevator for a ride to the top of their Soyuz rocket. It's where they board their spacecraft, which they've now been inside of for the past 2 hours.
Сережа!
Sergei Ryzhikov there. Sergei Kutsberchkov and Kate Rubens there waving their final goodbyes before they get into their Soyuz spacecraft, preparing for a launch that is now just 26 minutes away.
Here we go.
And we're back now with a live view of the crew inside their Soyuz MS-17, ready for launch. You can see here on the bottom corner, or bottom left-hand corner, Sergei Ryzhikov, who is the Soyuz commander for its trip to the International Space Station, And on the top right-hand side of the screen, Sergei Kuzmichkov. Out of view here is Kate Rubens, who is on Ryzhikov's other side, just out of view. And there we're seeing astronaut Kate Rubens in her seat to the right of Sergei Ryzhikov, waving to the audience and ready for her launch coming up now in 24 minutes and 14 seconds.
Have a safe trip. It's been a pleasure working with you.
And another live view of the Soyuz MS-17 on the launch pad in Baikonur. Liftoff scheduled for 12:45 a.m. Central Time, 10:45 a.m. in Baikonur. Atop the rocket and within the Soyuz spacecraft, as we just saw, are Kate Rubens, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kuzmichkov. Now just 23 minutes away from their launch.
The whole Soyuz spacecraft is 24 and a half feet long with an overall volume of 177 cubic feet and comprised of three modules. The descent module, situated in the middle of the Soyuz vehicle, contains customized seats for the crew members during launch, entry, and landing, and contains all the controls and displays necessary for the flight. It also houses life support systems, batteries for the re-entry and landing, and the parachute and soft landing rocket engines that slow the Soyuz just before touchdown as the spacecraft lands in Kazakhstan. There are 8 hydrogen peroxide thrusters located on the module, which are used to control the spacecraft's orientation, or attitude, during the descent until parachute deployment. The descent module also contains a guidance, navigation, and control system used to maneuver the vehicle during the descent phase of the mission. This descent module is 7.3 feet long with a diameter of 7.1 feet and a habitable volume of 124 cubic feet. It is the only portion of the Soyuz that survives the return to Earth. The orbital module at the top is 9.8 feet long. It connects to the descent module via pressurized hatch. This is where the crew has a small amount of room to move around following launch during the flight to the space station. It has a docking mechanism, hatch, and rendezvous antennas located at the front end. The docking mechanism is used to dock with the space station, and the hatch allows entry into the orbiting complex. The rendezvous antennas are used by the automated docking system, which uses radar, to maneuver toward the station for docking. There is also a forward-looking window in the module that the crew can use to take manual measurements of distance and closing speed with a laser rangefinder in the event of failure of the rendezvous radar system. The propulsion module houses the oxygen storage tanks, the main engine, and the attitude control thrusters, avionics, and communication and control equipment. The propulsion portion of this module handles all orbital maneuvers, including those needed for the rendezvous with the space station and the deorbit burn at the end of the spacecraft's mission. Before they are deployed, the two solar arrays are folded against the body of the propulsion module, which, along with the orbital module, separates from the descent module after the deorbit burn. The solar panels span almost 35 feet. The entire spacecraft serves not only as a crew transport vehicle to and from the space station, but also as an emergency return vehicle in the unlikely event that the crew needs to leave the station unexpectedly.
Now is from Sebastian asking, can astronaut Kate Rubens speak Russian? And she can. All astronauts who go to the International Space Station are required to speak both English and Russian. So Kate Rubens can speak Russian, and Sergei Ryzhikov and Sergei Kuzmichkov can both speak English as well. You can find that, you know, individuals vary on how comfortable they are with the language, but they at least have some baseline proficiency. That's, I've heard, particularly challenging, however, for our international partners from Japan and Canada, and not so much Canada since they speak English to begin with, but from the European countries who may not be speaking English as a foreign language because they learn Russian via English. So they are learning a foreign language while speaking a foreign language. And we have another question now from Brandon, who is asking, what role does NASA Mission Control play in the launch from Baikonur? The team here in the flight control room in Mission Control Houston is monitoring the events going on in Baikonur, but they don't have a great deal to do with the actual launch and ascent. What they are working on, however, is making sure that the International Space Station is ready for the Soyuz to dock to it later tonight. That docking is coming up at 3:52 a.m. Central Time, so it'll be a particularly short amount of time to get ready once launch is completed, but everything looking good on this end as well. They've been working ahead to make sure that when the Soyuz arrives, the Rosvet docking port and the crew on board will all be ready to greet it. One more question from social media, although you can keep them coming using the hashtag AskNASA. This one coming from Kay asking, do astronauts have a practice to stay mentally healthy and maintain their cognitive functions in space? That is a very important piece of the puzzle for astronauts working on board the International Space Station. One of the things that is part of the astronauts' training once they arrive at NASA and become astronauts is what we call expeditionary skills, and that is making sure that you are a good team member, you're serving your team well, and that can mean taking care of yourself, self-care, or taking care of your teammates, also being a leader or a follower as the situation calls for. That's a major part of their training, alongside more practical things like International Space Station systems and spacewalk training, but it's an important part of the training. Once again, you can send those questions in using the hashtag AskNASA on social media. We'll try to take a few more over the course of the night.
We are reporting on control panel pass 2. Copy you, Favor 1. Readiness is confirmed on the view. Copy. Favors, you are 10 minutes out from launch.
For those just joining us, you're looking at a live view of the Soyuz MS-17 that currently holds Kate Rubins, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kuzprichkov waiting their launch to the International Space Station. That's just 14 minutes to go now until today's liftoff, which is scheduled for 12:45 a.m. Central Time, 10:45 a.m. in Baikonur.
bridge temperature 4 degrees, testing and restart.
Minutes away from launch now, and we have some info for you now on the booster that will carry the crew into space today. The Soyuz rocket stands 162 feet tall, weighs about 640,000 pounds, and consists of the Soyuz MS-17 spacecraft inside a protective shroud at the top and the three-stage Soyuz 2.1A booster below. The spacecraft was made into its booster, and the three main stages were joined together on Saturday. Just 24 hours later, on Sunday, the Soyuz rocket began its trek to the launch pad right at 7 a.m. Baikonur time, arriving less than 2 hours later where it was raised into a vertical position for final pre-launch preparations. Now poised for launch with its three crew members on board, the Soyuz spacecraft sits high above the three stages of the Soyuz booster, which uses kerosene and liquid oxygen as the propellant. The first stage has four liquid engines strapped to the side of the core vehicle. Each will burn for 1 minute and 58 seconds before they drop away. The core engine of the first stage also serves as the second stage and continues to burn until 4 minutes and 57 seconds into the flight. The third stage has a single engine that will ignite before the separation of the second stage, helping to push it away safely. It will burn until the 8 minutes and 46 seconds mark of the flight. And at that point, the Soyuz spacecraft will separate from the third stage, having arrived at its preliminary orbit. Back now with a live view of the Soyuz on the pad in Baikonur. Just 12 minutes now from today's liftoff, scheduled for 12:45 a.m. Central, 10:45 in Baikonur. Getting a lot of questions on social media about the music that we're hearing. That is played for the benefit of the crew and chosen by the crew. Don't have information on which crew member chose which particular songs that they get to hear, but it's possible that any of them could have. One of the other things that the crew gets to choose is the zero gravity indicator that they take with them into space. For this mission, the zero gravity indicator that the crew uses is a small knitted cosmonaut that was made by Sergei Kunzverchkov's wife. This will be hanging from the ceiling of the Soyuz so that they are able to tell when it no longer hangs and starts to float that they have successfully made it to microgravity and are in space. Each crew is able to choose a different talisman to serve that purpose. One other milestone to note today before we get into the last few minutes of the countdown is that it is astronaut Kate Rupin's birthday. She will be launching with an extremely big birthday candle, making her way to the International Space Station and having an extra reason to celebrate today. Getting back some views of the crew inside the Soyuz. Now less than 10 minutes away from today's launch. This is Kate Rubens again celebrating her birthday today with a launch to the International Space Station. You got mud on your face. Big disgrace. NASA and Roscosmos representatives are watching just a short distance away from the launch pad in Baikonur. For an update on activities there, we're going to go now to NASA Public Affairs Officer Rob Navius.
Brandy, it has been a very different atmosphere at the Baikonur Cosmodrome than we're typically accustomed to in the run-up to launch. So many global events have been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic, and this launch is no different. Stringent precautions have been taken to ensure that the crew remains isolated from everyone except essential personnel. And face masks and social distancing are the name of the game here for everyone and anyone in close proximity to the crew or Russian and American support teams. There are no family members attending launch and no VIPs for this final crewed launch of the year. Kate Rubens and her crewmates are ready for a super-fast express ride to the space station. This first two-orbit scheme for the crew, following five two-orbit test runs with Progress cargo ships. Ironically enough, it will take us around an hour to get back into the town of Baikonur from our launch complex viewing site at Site 31. It'll take just 3 hours for Rubens and her crewmates to arrive at the International Space Station. Nonetheless, even with just a fraction of the people usually in attendance here, the excitement is as palpable as ever as we approach launch. That's it from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan. Now back to you at Mission Control in Houston.
Thanks, Rob. We are now at the T-minus 7-minute point. Pre-launch operations are complete. At this point in the countdown, the Soyuz's first and second stage engines are ready for launch, and telemetry has been received from the rocket, indicating that all primary and backup systems are set to support liftoff. At the time of launch, at 6 minutes and 40 seconds now, the International Space Station is going to be flying 259 miles over northwest Uzbekistan at the border of Kazakhstan, 339 miles ahead of the Soyuz as it leaves the launch pad. The launch is precisely timed for the moment when the Earth's rotation will place the Baikonur Cosmodrome in the plane of the orbit of the space station. Six minutes now until launch. At this point, the launch key has been inserted in the launch bunker. That's a real key that transitions the launch sequence into automatic mode.
Ground measurement system is activated by run one command.
5 minutes now until launch. Onboard systems have been switched to onboard control. The commander's cockpit displays and controls have been activated, and the crew members are closing their helmets, putting them on suit oxygen. Four minutes and counting now until Cade Rubens, Sergei Kudryashkov, and Sergei Ryzhikov make their way to the International Space Station. At this point, fuel lines and other elements of the rocket engines are being purged with nitrogen to fireproof them by removing vapors of fuel and oxidizer. 3 minutes and counting now. Today's liftoff at 12:45 a.m. Central Time.
Ground fuel and oxidizer and nitrogen to the vehicle is terminated.
Booster's fuel tanks now being pressurized for flight, optimizing the flow of fuel and helping to add structural support to the rocket.
When you have a chance, because... What about my watch? Pressurization?
Two minutes left before today's liftoff. Back with an inside view, looking at Sergei Ryzhikov and Sergei Kuzverchkov. 1 minute and 30 seconds left to go before liftoff. Ground propellant feed has now been terminated. One minute to go. Soyuz is now on internal power. As we speak, the space station's flying directly over the Baikonur Cosmodrome in the launch pad. At the time of launch, the station will be 339 miles above the Soyuz as it leaves the pad. There's the first umbilical tower separating from the booster.
Launch.
Second umbilical now separating.
Ignition.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Intermediate. Main. Lift.
And lift off. Kate Rubin, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kuzverchkov now on their way to the International Space Station. The latest in a chain that spans almost 20 years of continuous human presence in space.
10 seconds, the parameters of the rocket are nominal. 20 seconds, the thrusters of the first and second stage are operating nominally.
Hearing first good reports of a good first stage performance, everything looking nominal. Soyuz is currently delivering 930,000 pounds of thrust from its four boosters and single engine of that first stage. It measures 68 feet in length and 24 feet in diameter and burns liquid fuel for the first 2 minutes and 6 seconds of flight.
50 seconds. The pressure in the chambers is nominal. Everything is good on board. We feel well.
Good reports from the crew as well. Everything looking good with today's flight.
Roll pitch, y'all,
all normal, meaning the spacecraft is exactly where it's expected to be at this point. Velocity is 1,100 miles per hour. First stage of the Soyuz, less than a minute of flight time left now.
80 seconds, parameters are nominal. On board, everything is good. We feel well. We feel the G-loads.
First milestone we'll be watching for here is the escape tower jettison, which will come at the 1 minute and 54 second mark, a little less than 10 seconds now.
T jettison.
Escape tower has been jettisoned.
Separation of the side units.
And there is the separation of the four strap-on boosters that are jettisoned. These have completed their job and are dropping away now at an altitude of 28 miles above the Earth. While the Soyuz continues on with its flight, traveling at about 3,350 miles an hour, powered by the rocket's second or core stage.
Rocket parameters are nominal.
All still looking good, and the next milestone we're looking for is the jettison of the launch shroud at 2 minutes and 37 seconds. And you see that launch shroud jettison? We're now getting some views from the external rocket camera.
Copy you.
Looking towards the bottom of this rocket and at the Earth below, solar arrays waiting to be unfurled once the spacecraft reaches orbit safely. Soyuz is traveling at a speed of 4,700 miles an hour at this point.
Steady. On board, everything is good. We feel well.
Continuing to hear good calls from the crew. The core stage performing as expected. The core stage of the Soyuz is 56 feet in length and 13.5 feet in diameter with a single engine and four fuel chambers providing between 178,000 and 222,000 pounds of thrust at various points of its 3 minutes and 28 seconds of operation.
We are anticipating the next separation. Copy all.
This stage will continue to burn until the 4 minute and 43 second mark. Soyuz uses what's called a hot stage technique, meaning third stage ignites while the second is still burning.
230 seconds stabilization of the craft is doing well.
4 minutes into the ascent of Soyuz MS-17 now, Kate Rubin, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kudryavtsev on their way to the International Space Station following today's 12:45 a.m. Central launch from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan.
250 seconds pitch raw and rotation is nominal.
Everything continuing to go well in the climb to orbit. We'll be looking for a next second stage cutoff coming up at the 4 minute and 45 second mark, about 15 seconds from now. All still looking good. 4 minutes and 45 seconds in, third stage is igniting. Second stage should be shutting down.
We have confirmation of the initiation of thrusters of the third stage and unpowering of thrusters of the second stage. Copy all. We feel well. Everything is nominal on board. I understand.
As you heard there, everything's still looking good. Core booster separated at an altitude of 105 miles, and with it gone, Soyuz is now being propelled by a single engine of its third stage. That engine provides 67,000 pounds of thrust and will burn for 4 minutes and 2 seconds. Day's flight going smoothly and all systems working nominally. The crew reporting that they are feeling good and on their way to the space station.
Copy. On board, everything is good. We feel great. Seconds. Flight is nominal. Copy. Everything is good on board.
About 2 minutes left before the crew is officially in space and in orbit. Next milestone that we'll be watching for comes at the 8 minute and 46 second mark. That's the third stage cutoff and separation.
Copy. Everything is good on board. We feel well. Seconds stabilization of the vehicle is steady. Copy. Everything is good on board.
Crews still calling down that everything is looking good inside the Soyuz rocket. You're seeing a view from cameras on the exterior of the Soyuz here, looking down towards the bottom of the rocket. And in the forescreen, solar array that will unfold once the crew does make it safely to orbit.
Everything is good on board. We feel well.
Now 7.5 minutes into today's flight. Velocity of the Soyuz is 13,500 miles an hour. Once this final third stage delivers the Soyuz to orbit and the module is separated, a series of pre-programmed commands will be executed to prepare the Soyuz for orbital operations. Those stored commands are called time tag commands and allow many of the Soyuz systems to be automatically activated by onboard computers at precise times stored in the computers.
170 seconds, the thrusters.
About 45 seconds left before the crew is on orbit and safely in space. Everything still looking good for today's flight.
Flight is nominal. Copy all. Everything is good on board. We are standing by for the separation. 520 seconds. Everything is nominal. Prepare for the separation. 530 seconds. Thrusters powered off, confirmed. Separation is confirmed.
And there you heard this confirmation that the third stage cut off and separated as planned. Single liquid-fueled engine shut down and dropped away at an altitude of 126 miles above the Earth. And there you see it now also. The Soyuz have unfurled. That's a key milestone as well, to ensure that the Soyuz is able to power itself on its journey to the International Space Station.
Taboris, this is MCC Moscow. We copy you. How do you read us? We read you loud and clear. How about us? Loud and clear.
Control of the spacecraft from this point will be overseen by the Russian Mission Control Center outside of Moscow that you're hearing call to the crew now.
Closed, and pressurization is nominal. Copy. We are working on the video. Video is on. Copy, RDR 856. Okay, we copy you. And also, we are pulling up the velocity screen display. MCC Moscow, please take the measurements for this current time. 811, pressure 814. Copy.
Following today's launch just 10 minutes ago now at 12:45 a.m. Central Time, Kate Rubens, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kuznetsov are now safely in orbit and on their way to the International Space Station following a flawless launch and 8.5-minute climb to orbit. They'll be working through some initial checkouts now, but everything is looking good as they head off on the first two-orbit rendezvous for a human crew with the space station. That's scheduled for 3:52 a.m. Central Time when they'll dock to the Rosvet module on the Russian segment of the space station.
It is on. Copy. The second set of the course hardware is powered on. Copy.
And heard there that the Kurs antenna that will be used to guide the Soyuz to its automated docking past its checkout. That's one of the key milestones that occurs once the Soyuz does reach orbit.
Copy.
Also be doing some leak checks and communication checkouts, making sure everything is looking good as the Soyuz heads on its way.
We have confirmation of operations of our mode. Angular rates are along the pitch and yaw are less than 10 degrees. Copy. Standing by for your filled out form 03. You ready to copy? Yes, we are. 17.4. 16.4, 368, 20, 2.0, 21, 1.8, 22, 30.24, 24, 19.3, 25th, 17.3, 26, 367. Propellant 878. Tobor 2, we have copied the data for Form 3. Let's check the configuration. MCC Moscow. We have GSO 1.
КВ 2, 1.
And КВ 1 and 2. We are going through the test of the first set of the hardware. Okay, Tabor, after the first burn, we will transition to the first manifold. Okay, copy, we will transition to the first manifold. After the first approach burn, once you receive the GSO, let's do tests of the manual controls at 09:53:00. It is written in your procedures.
Как приняли фаворы?
Тобос, how do you copy?
Фаворы СУПУ Москвы.
Тобос, МСС Москва. Тобос, МСС Москва, we do not copy you.
Значит, Тобос, если нас слышите, ты с ручного управления завершить до боковой коррекции.
Тобос, if you hear us, complete test of the manual mode.
Мы вас сейчас принимаем. Мы вас сейчас слышим.
Copy, we hear you now.
Вас слышим хорошо.
We also hear you well. Copy. So complete the test before the side burn. After the burn, we will go to КДУ mode. Okay, copy. We have confirmation of the check of the first курс set. Copy. We are standing by for your confirmation. Copy. In 5 minutes after pressure checks, the pressures are 811, 874. Copy.
Фаворы сейчас у кого передача нормально?
Тобос, how do you copy us now?
У нас блик солнечный на ТС-8.
Я понял.
We have a solar glare on ТС-8. But the LED is on. Copy. Tabor, we are completing the compass at
09:05.
Copy, 09:05. Burn will last 13 minutes 30 seconds. Next compass is at 09:16. Тобор, all of the elements of your structure were feathered nominally. The parameters are nominal. The band is 51.6.
Разрешаем ослабить плечевые ремни, открыть гермошлем.
You are go to loosen the shoulder straps to open up your helmets and to check the thermal sensors. How do you copy?
Разрешаем действие в рамке.
MCC Moscow, Topors, copy you. It is time.
Crews continuing to go through their checkouts that occur once the Soyuz does make it to orbit. They launched again at 12:45, just as planned, and the launch went smoothly. We've been getting your questions using the hashtag AskNASA, and we're going to take a couple before we go into some launch replays that are coming up next. This first one coming from Avia, who's asking how much G-force the crew sees during their ascent to space. At the launch, the crew experiences about 1.7 times the force of gravity, and by the time the solid rocket boosters separate, about 2 minutes into the flight, it'll be already over 2 times the force of gravity. During the last minute of ascent, which that's about 7.5 minute point until about 8.5 minutes, when the main engines are ignited in that last little climb, they experience about 3 times the force of gravities. Then you go from that straight into zero once they reach zero gravity. We also have another question. This one coming to us from...
Indicators, are they all nominal? Did you check?
This one coming to us from Kent, asking whether or not astronauts sleep during flight or eat. And because this one is a very short flight, they probably will not have time to take a nap. Maybe they can grab a snack. They have been sitting and waiting for launch for several hours now, so that would be one of the first things I might reach for. But on some travels to the International Space Station can take much longer. Used to the journey would take a couple of days. It's continued to get shorter and shorter for Soyuz crew members, but for instance, the first SpaceX Dragon crew that launched earlier this year had about a day's amount of time between their launch and their docking at the International Space Station, so they did get a little bit of time to take a quick nap and grab something to eat. In a few minutes, we hope to have some additional views of launch to play for you. That again took place at 12:45 a.m. Central Time on the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan. Crew continuing to go through their early checkouts. Now that they are safely in orbit and everything going smoothly so far. They continue at that rate. They are scheduled to dock to the International Space Station at 3:52 a.m. Central Time today. And here are those replays beginning now. These coming from different cameras than we were able to see in real time when the Soyuz MS-17 lifted off from the launch pad 31, launch site 31 in the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan at 12:45 a.m. Central. On board, Kate Rubens, Sergei Kudryashkov, and Sergei Ryzhikov, now all on their way to the International Space Station. second view there of today's launch at 12:45. We'll have a total of 5 of these replays for you.
Thank you.
That was a series of replays of today's 12:45 a.m. Central Time launch. The crew on board, NASA astronaut Kate Rubens and Roscosmos cosmonauts Sergei Kuznetsov and Soyuz Commander Sergei Ryzhikov are all now on their way to the International Space Station and scheduled to make the first two-orbit rendezvous for a Soyuz with crew aboard. That is coming up at 3:52 a.m. Central today, so you won't you'll want to stay tuned to NASA TV. We're going to take a quick break now that the crew is safely in orbit, but we'll be back at 3 a.m. Central for our docking coverage. Again, that docking scheduled to occur at 3:52 a.m., after which we'll take a quick break while we show you some post-launch video files and then come back for hatch opening coverage at 5 a.m. Today's activities will wrap up at 5:45 a.m. when the hatch is open and the International Space Station is able to welcome their three new crew members. And then we will finish up the day with a video file of all of it at 8 a.m. That's all that's coming up here on NASA TV. So stick with us tonight and get ready to welcome the new crew members to the International Space Station. This is Mission Control Houston.